get to your desks, clean them up a little bit. We're going to have a photograph we're sending around. So everybody to their desks. We're going to get going here just shortly. All right, everybody, we're going to be sitting for this photo because we're going to be looking up above the clock. We're sending this to Senator Diedrich and former Senator Duvall with very well wishes. Dave Bordwick, the big camera is right behind you. Big camera's right. All right, everybody, sit down. Everybody, sit down in your desk for this photo. Nice and uniform. Nice and uniform. Speaker, you all ready? All right. All right, on three, everybody, say hello to these guys. One, two, three. Hello. All right. Thank you very much for that that privilege. We appreciate it.
The house will come to order. Today we will be led in prayer by Pastor Jake Cron, and Jennifer Barnett from Wagner will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Pastor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this afternoon we come before you with great thanksgiving in our hearts for the men and women here today who serve our state. I pray that each one would recognize the sacred trust of the work that they do, and that you would enable them to do that work thoughtfully and with excellence. As they consider the business placed before them today, I ask for you to give them your divine wisdom and discernment. May they be full of your grace and compassion as they consider the impact of their work today, and may they have the courage to lead in ways that promote what is good and true according to your will. And as they serve, I pray that your blessings would be poured out upon them, their families, and their communities. May they live each day with a sense of God-given purpose, and may they steward well the opportunities they have to serve you and to serve our state. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Will the clerk please call the roll?
Representative Arlen, Elk, Elward, Baumoller, Blair, Calise, Kamak, Chafee, Chase, Consett, DeGroote, Derby, Deutsch, Donnell, Drury, Duba, Duffy, Emery, Fitzgerald, Gross, Hansen, Healy, Heerman, Jameson, Jensen, Kevin, Jensen, Phil, Carr, Kasson, Koth, Cromer, Kroll, Cole, Ladner, Lems, Lesmeister, Massey, May, Mills, Moore, Mortensen, Mullally, Mulder, Nelson, Odenbach, Otten, Ernie, Overwig, Perry, Peterson, Drew, Peterson, Sue, Pino, Poyer, Randolph, Rehfeldt, Reimer, Reich, Sauter, Schaefbauer, Schneider, Schorma, Sharda, Soy, St. John, Stevens, Tunison, Tordson, Van Huysen, Wangsness, Wisegram, Whitman, Speaker Bartles.
Here.
Mr. Speaker, there is a quorum.
Approval of the journal.
Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that the Chief Clerk of the House has had under consideration the House Journal of the 26th day. All errors, typographical or otherwise, are duly marked in the temporary journal for correction, and we hereby move the adoption of the report respectfully submitted. Hugh Bartles, Chair.
The motion before the House is the approval of the journal. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed say nay. Motion carried. We have at least four groups of students in the galleries. The journal is the minutes of what happened on the floor here yesterday. Is the doctor of the day in the audience? Dr. Poppinga? Well, we'll put that off for a little bit. Communications, item business number four.
Mr. Speaker and members of the House of Representatives, I have the honor to inform you that on February 20th, 2024, I approved House Bills 1034, 1049, and 1128, and the same have been deposited in the office of the Secretary of State. Respectfully submitted, Kristi Noem, Governor. Mr. Speaker and members of the House of Representatives, I have the honor to inform you that on February 21st, 2024, I approved House Bills 1029, 1067, 1073, 1097, and 1127, and the same have been deposited in the office of the Secretary of State. Respectfully submitted, Kristi Noem, Governor.
Reports of standing committees.
Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that the Office of Engrossing and Enrolling has carefully compared House Bill 1023, 1091, 1104, 1129, and 1163, and finds the same correctly enrolled. Respectfully submitted, Hugh Bartles, Chair. Mr. Speaker, the Joint Committee on Appropriations respectfully reports that House Bill 1016, 1080, and 1144 were tabled. Respectfully submitted, Mike Derby, co-chair. Respectfully submitted, Gene Hunhoff, co-chair. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee on House State Affairs respectfully reports that Senate Bill 76 do pass and be placed on the consent calendar, Senate Bill 99 and 119 be amended and do pass. Respectfully submitted, Will Mortensen, Chair. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee on House Commerce and Energy reports that Senate Bill 58 be amended and do pass, Senate Bill 84 do pass and be placed on the consent calendar. Senate Bill 81 and 86 do pass. Respectfully submitted, Mike Weisgram, Chair. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee on House Judiciary respectfully reports that Senate Bill 9, 85, and 97 do pass. Senate Bill 15 and 98 do pass and be placed on the consent calendar. Respectfully submitted, John Hansen, Chair.
Messages from the Senate.
Mr. Speaker, I have the honor to return herewith House Bill 1023, 1104, 1129, and 1163, which have passed the Senate without change. Also, Mr. Speaker, I have the honor to return herewith House Bill 1082, which has been amended by the Senate, and your concurrence in the amendments is respectfully requested. Also, Mr. Speaker, I have the honor to transmit herewith Senate Bill 13, 191, 198, 199, and 212, which have passed the Senate, and your favorable consideration is requested. Respectfully, Peggy Lorenz, Secretary.
Item of business number eight, motions and resolutions. This time there was a notice yesterday of motion to reconsider. I need to remind the member that he needs to make that motion now. Seeing no motion, we'll move on to item of business number nine, consideration of reports of committees.
Representative Mortensen moved that the reports of the standing committees on House Appropriation on House Bill 1118, as found on page 352 of the House Journal, be adopted.
The motion before the House is Representative Mortensen's motion that we adopt the reports of the Standing Committee of House Appropriations on House Bill 1118. Yesterday we read that bill under consideration of reports of standing committees. It was amended. At this point we would be accepting that report so it can be placed on today's calendar for discussion. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion carries. First reading of Senate bills.
Senate Bill 13, revise the process for nominating candidates for the offices of Lieutenant Governor, Attorney General, and Secretary of State. Senate Bill 191, restrict the use of medical cannabis for individuals on probation or conditional release. Senate Bill 198, authorize school districts and non-public schools to acquire and administer nasal glucagon. Senate Bill 199, revised provisions pertaining to the consolidation of boundary changes of counties. Senate Bill 212, allow for the payment of goods or services by a school district between school board meetings in certain circumstances.
For the students in the audience and those at home, this reading of House bills is of all bills required to be read twice. They're read when they're introduced in the House bills, and there are no House bills to read as the time for filing House bills has passed. So we just have first reading of Senate bills. I'm going to assign these bills now to House Education, Senate Bill 212, to House Human Services, Senate Bill 198, to House Judiciary, Senate Bill 191, to House Local Government, Senate Bill 99, and to House State Affairs, Senate Bill 13. Second reading of the consent calendar items.
Representative Poyer requested that Senate Bill 169 be removed from the consent calendar. Senate Bill 188, modify the time before which rural access infrastructure grant monies must be expended or obligated. Senate Bill 194, create a license plate for certain retired firefighters and clarify provisions regarding special firefighter license plates.
The consent calendar, having had its second reading, is up for consideration. The consent calendar are items that pass through House committees with no dissenting votes, and no member objected to it being placed on the consent calendar, and it was certified by the chair that it was eligible. The items on the consent calendar are voted on as a group. There is no debate on the items, but members may ask questions. Are there any questions on the consent calendar items? Hearing none, this consent calendar is up for final consideration. Those in favor will vote yay. Those opposed will vote nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote. Representative Potter? No. Duba, excuse me.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Hermione Granger to you. It is crossover day, and I'm wearing my black robe. So there you go. And I have a weapon, and I may use it.
No props on the floor.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. On a serious note, we were treated today in both the speakers in the Senate lobby by the South Dakota Families for Vaccines. The South Dakota Families for Vaccines is a grassroots network of South Dakotans dedicated to advocating for public health, rooted in fact-based public policy and promoting immunizations across the lifespan for healthier families and communities. We organize volunteers who are parents, physicians, families, and citizens in every field and area of our state, as well as collaborate with leading medical, public health, and community partners to educate South Dakotans about vaccine science, public health, and why safe communities are so important. South Dakota Families for Vaccines is happy to participate in our first day of advocacy at the Capitol today, and they've enjoyed important conversations with our lawmakers about the significance of good pro-vaccine policies and how vital public health is to our state. And let's welcome them. They're sitting right up here.
Representative Sauter.
Personal privilege?
Granted.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. At the front of the chamber today, I'd like to introduce, on behalf of my colleagues in District 4 and District 8, the very good-looking government class from Dewbrook High School and their teacher, Mr. Moberg.
Representative Chafee.
Representative Gross.
May I have a personal privilege, please?
Granted.
Thank you. Fellow members of the House, please join me in welcoming members of the West Central High School there who are here with their teachers, Kat Davis and Joanne Bowl. They represent the Humboldt and Hartford communities, which is a combination of District 25 and 9. And I welcome them on behalf of my fellow representatives. So join me in thanking them for being here. They're scattered around up here, I believe.
Representative St. John. Mr. Speaker, all members have voted.
The clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were ayes 69, excused 1.
The consent calendar, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Second reading of House bills and joint resolutions.
House Bill 1039, an act to provide for the payment of legal expenses originating from crime committed at a facility maintained by the Department of Corrections.
House Bill 1039, having had its second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks? Representative Otten.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Back in about May, end of May, June, I got a call from a commissioner, and he was telling me that indigent costs on our correctional facilities that are in these counties were being paid by the counties. And of course, my first remark was, no, the AG takes care of that, and I was gonna let it go, but he was adamant that that was the case. So did a little research, and lo and behold, he was correct. We have a statute 23A/40/7, representation provided by a county or municipality for indigents detained without formal charges. So the counties are picking it up. So, all right, I started thinking, all right, how many do we have? Well, you've got Pennington, you've got Hughes, Minnehaha, Yankton, and then Bonhom. We've got correctional facilities in these places, and the residents in those counties are paying for all the indigent costs, legal costs. Now, if you remember, the Supreme Court justice just a few weeks back was talking about indigent costs, about the state actually picking some of those up, and I was kind of excited when I heard that, you know, I guess I'm not way out in left field, maybe in the ballpark. So I started making phone calls back in June, and as I checked with the county officials, how much does this cost? I mean, what's the depth of this legal cost? And what I got was principally crickets. It's been going on for such a long period of time, they don't monitor it. So I called DOC. How many people do we have that are being picked up by the counties? We don't know. Just, you know, we intern them, we've got no clue. So you begin to, at that time I started writing the bill in itself. I had two actually drafted, and what you see is the latter form of what I thought was actually workable. And as I began to work through this problem, the thing that really, I guess, got my goat, if you will, is that you've got five counties that have the correctional facilities in them. And we all know that those residents in those counties weren't waving the flags, please put the facilities here. But yet they're the ones incurring this cost. All the other counties are just shipping their folks there and absolutely no cost to them. And that's just plain unjust. And when you look at taxation, that is one thing that you look at, is making sure that everything is equal, that everything lifts, a smaller amount can lift the boat a whole lot more than just a few. And so what you see before you is the culmination of that work. Did in section one, as you go down to about 11, we can find exactly what we're gonna be talking about of legal costs. It has to happen in the penitentiary. So I'm trying to hold down the cost on that. Well, we came up with kind of a rough number, and it's a rough number because we don't know. We'll only know as this moves forward. It's about $250,000. I've got that in a motion sheet. And depending on if this thing fails, I'll get rid of the motion sheet. If it goes over to the Senate side, we'll see what they deal with it, and then I'll deal with the motion sheet at a later date. But I want to make it very clear that number that I'm thinking that is pretty spot on and is going to work. If we have extra costs at the correctional facilities, that number could jump to $300,000, $400,000. Or it could do the opposite. It could go down to $150,000. So each year from now on, you're going to have a number. Somebody stands up here if I'm not the one, and you're going to have a different number jumping up and down. That's because of those costs. And when you think that, well, that's kind of odd. No, it's not really not, because we do that in fire suppression. We backfill all the time. But this was a way to get at least a baseline started for this switch of actually having the state pick up those costs that they should have always picked up. But we have a tendency around here to like to shift those costs to the county commissioners and let them complain about it. So that in a nutshell is everything that I've got, and I'll stand by for questions.
Further remarks on House Bill 1039. Hearing no further remarks on House Bill 1039, the question before the House is the final passage of 1039. Those in favor will vote yea, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Consett.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I've got something interesting to share with you all today. I would like to introduce to you Bryce Healy. And this is an interesting story, and I won't take long. He was the director of school and public lands, the last elected Democrat to a constitutional office in the state. He is now working with Representative Tortson as an economic development specialist at Sioux Metro Growth Alliance, where great things are happening. And he is my brother-in-law. Welcome to the House.
Representative Duba, Representative Randolph, Mr. Speaker, all members have voted.
The clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are ayes 69, excused 1.
House Bill 1039, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the title? Seeing none, it is deemed correct.
House Bill 1060, an act to revise certain provisions related to travel reimbursement.
House Bill 1060, having had its second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks? Representative Carr.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and my fellow representatives, I ask you to support HB 1060. 1060 does three things regarding reimbursements. One, it's going to adjust the reimbursement rate for mileage. I'm going to come back to that in a second. It also adjusts the reimbursement rate for in-state lodging for when somebody wants to use the state rate. So somebody who's a state employee or perhaps a legislator. And it also adjusts the daily meal allowance for our highway patrol troopers. Going back to the mileage rate, if you might recall last year I brought a bill that addressed this very thing and said, we're going to adjust the mileage rate and set it to the IRS. So we're going to index it to the IRS reimbursement rate. Why is that important? Why did we want to do that? Because right now it has to get set. It goes through a process so we can have a leg. I think the IRS rate is a fair rate. And it's known, it's widely used. Everybody knows what that is. So the mileage rate would go from 51 cents to 65 and a half cents per mile. That would be the change in the reimbursement based on the current IRS rate. The in-state lodging reimbursement rate would go from $75 to $107 a night. It's been a while since we've adjusted that. How do I know that? Because about 7 years ago, as an appropriator, and if you've been following along for a few years, I'm not big on spending money, but that was one of the first things that I got behind. I said, I think we need to address this. because I believe at that time it was at $50, and we adjusted to $75. So put yourself in the position of coming to a meeting during the interim, and you come to Pier, and you call around and go, hey, do you have a state rate? That hotel may say, yeah, we do. Or it got to a point where it's saying, you know what, $50 wasn't enough. We got to give it to somebody else who's going to pay us, you know, the $130, $200. So we upped it to $75. Here we are, fast forward. Look at the inflation that we've had over the last 7 years. We're going up to $105, $107 per night. And then lastly, the highway patrol troopers, this would increase their daily meal allowance from $14 to $17. That's what this bill does. It has a fiscal impact. The general fund dollars are $438,000 approximately. The federal fund portion is $279,000. And there's another fund component, $850,000. So the total fund is $1.5 million is what that total fiscal impact will have on our budget. Have no fear. It's already part of what the governor recommended. It's in FY25. So it's already in the budget. We don't have to come up with extra dollars. And right now it's sitting in a pool in BFM just waiting for us to pass this bill. I'll stand by for questions. Thank you.
Further remarks on House Bill 1060. Hearing no further remarks, the question before the House is final passage of House Bill 1060. Those in favor vote yea, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote. Is the doctor of the day in the audience? Well, we're not going to be here very long, so I'm going to announce the doctor of the day. The doctor of the day program is sponsored by the South Dakota State Medical Association. Today's doctor of the day is Nicole Poppinga, MD. Dr. Poppinga moved to South Dakota to attend the University of Sioux Falls, but then trained at North Dakota and Missouri before returning from residency to Pierre to practice a combined internal medicine and pediatrics position at Avera Medical Group. She moved to Sioux Falls in 2016, was employed at the South Dakota Urban Indian Health from 2017 through 2021, and has been employed at the Avera Medical Group, and now has transitioned to a pediatric hospitalist. She enjoys advocating for equitable care for all and has worked as a consultant for the Maternal Health Care Division of the South Dakota Department of Health. Dr. Poppinga is an active member of the South Dakota State Medical Association since 2011 and has served on the South Dakota AAP and the National AAP. Please thank Dr. Poppinga for taking care of us today. For the students, since we have four or five student groups here, today is crossover day. That's the last day a bill that originated in the House can be acted on in the House. We only have three bills to act on today, and I don't even have to look. I know that is an all-time low record. I think our first 2 years here, Representative Carr, if you correct me, I think we were here till 10:30. 9:45 and 10:30 those nights, getting through all the bills we had to process. We had 30 plus bills, I believe. Cover the clock one day. Yeah, we put the clock so we didn't know it was midnight. But we're doing really well with three bills. I think it's a record.
Ray Felt votes aye.
Record, Mr. Representative Wagness beat you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Personal privilege.
Granted.
So with my district mate, Representative Moore, and myself, we have four of our 12 schools here today. Hoven with Mr. Mike Hobart, Sunshine Bible Academy with Michael Kitchen, and...
And then we got Mulbridge School with Mr. Weisbach, and we also have the Ipswich students with Mrs. Kless all in the gallery with us today. Please help us welcome them.
Representative Jameson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Personal privilege and a special,
granted,
special personal privilege with all the Sioux Falls legislators, if they could join me in this. Today was Sioux Falls Day, and up in the gallery we have members of the Sioux Falls Chamber, and there's the two classes of the Leadership Sioux Falls Group. They served us lunch today. A very good lunch, and we want to welcome them to the Capitol and thank them for lunch. Please join me.
Representative Sauter.
May I have another personal privilege,
granted,
please? Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In our gallery today, we have former legislator Randy Frederick and his very tolerant wife, Cindy. Thank you.
And I believe he's also a current Board of Regent. Regent.
Mr. Speaker, all members have voted.
Please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were ayes 69, excused 1.
House Bill 1060, having received a majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Seeing none, it is deemed correct.
House Bill 1118, an act to revise unclaimed property provisions.
House Bill 1118, having had its second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks?
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Van Huysen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Happy to be asking for your favorable support today, House Bill 1118. This is a bill that deals with kind of a technical matter about our budget process. You know, most state agencies, really almost all state agencies, they have a general fund budget. It's approved by the legislature each year. It sets forth how much they can spend, how many employees they can have. If they want to make a change, they put that request through the budget process. It comes through our Appropriations Committee. It comes through this House floor. It comes through the Senate floor. That is how state agency budgets work. It's not how the budget works for the administration of unclaimed property. The way that that works is a continuous appropriation, which means that the unclaimed property comes in tens of millions of dollars a year, and there's a continuous appropriation to spend as much as the state treasurer wishes to administer that program. Now, I would say the state treasurer today and his predecessors have been responsible in how they spend that. I don't think that they're spending vastly more than is necessary, but still, it's really not the best process to have a state agency that can spend without the oversight of the legislature. So what would this bill do? Well, it would leave a couple things in place that are important. First of all, it doesn't change anything about the payment of claims. If someone comes in and claims their unclaimed property, they can pay that out. Doesn't matter if it's $5 or $5 million or $50 million, there's no limit on that. That's continuously appropriated. Secondly, it doesn't change the ability of the treasurer to incur the costs he needs to incur to receive unclaimed property or to put it out, particularly the audit costs and some of those processing costs. What it would do, though, is it would take the more predictable annual expenses, their contracting costs, their processing, their software, their staff costs, and instead of taking it out of unclaimed property on the front end, it would come out of the general fund on the back end. Now, the unclaimed property that isn't spent goes into the general fund. So this is a neutral change to the budget. It doesn't cost the budget anything. If this bill passes, we've been talking about motion sheets today on these last couple bills. Motion sheets are how we do amendments to the General Appropriations Act in our committee. I have a motion sheet that would change the budget for the State Treasurer's Office to comply with this law, but it would reflect the expenses that he's currently incurring. It's not a cut. It's not a change. It's just a change in the process so that if next year, or 5 years from now, or 10 years from now, this state treasurer, or a future one, wants to come in and increase what is being spent on any of those administrative areas, add more staff, do more outreach, they have to come through the budget process, just like if the Department of Education wants to do more, just like if the Attorney General wants to do more, even our own legislative staff wants to do more, they have to do this. I put an amendment on the bill yesterday. I've spoken to the Bureau of Finance and Management. They are not in opposition to this, and they've told me that this bill is workable in its current form and doesn't cause any problems in the administration of unclaimed property. There are other state programs that are similar. The state health plan is similar. They have a continuous appropriation to pay out claims, but a generally funded administration, similar deal. So I'd ask for your favorable support. This is about putting a little more of our legislative oversight on a very important state program. Thank you.
Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, the question before the House is final passage. Oh, excuse me, Representative Perry, I didn't hear you.
Mr. Speaker, on this bill, I do have a couple things, and for the people here. Unclaimed property expenses have gone down over the past 5 years. I like the fact that my friend from Minnehaha has brilliant, great, and good thoughts. However, sometimes we have to go back to the old-fashioned way where we sit here and say, and I think my friend over here to my left from Beetle has said this before, if it's not broke, let's not fix it. This is one of those things where they're doing a very good job. There's 65 groups that have a similar type arrangement with how they handle their funds, and yet this is the one that we're looking at to change. It would be my impression that this is one of those we're going after something that doesn't need to be gone after. It is something that is working. For those of you who have had unclaimed property tax refunds, I think the governor got $391 the other day. We have had some really good successes. I don't think we need to fix this at this time, although I'm just one person, but I am one person that's going to be voting no on this.
Further remarks? Representative Mullally.
Thank you. I'm glad you could hear me. Question for the sponsor?
Please ask your question.
May I ask why the amendment went from $50,000 to $500,000?
Representative Van Huysen, do you wish to answer that question?
Yes, Mr. Speaker.
Please answer it.
The state treasurer felt that if with the removal of the continuous appropriation that it would make sense for him to have a slightly larger, well, quite a bit larger, reserve amount to cover some of those costs, because right now he can spend as much as he needs to out of the fund. And so we go from 50 to 500. Again, that's just withheld from the unclaimed property. And if it's not used, it would just carry over to the next year. That was the purpose. It doesn't really increase the cost of the program.
Further remarks, Representative Mullally.
Thank you, Speaker. So did the department agree with this amendment?
Representative Van Huysen, do you wish to answer that question? I believe it was a question.
Yes, Mr. Speaker. The state treasurer is opposed, and why wouldn't he be? Who wants more legislative oversight? I don't think we've had one department in front of us who would volunteer for that, but it's important that we protect that. As I said, the Bureau of Finance Management is not opposed and has said that this bill is workable.
Further remarks, Representative Mullally. Further remarks on the bill. Representative May.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Question for the sponsor.
Please ask your question, Representative May.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So if we have 65 informational budgets, why this one? Why not all of them? Why are we just looking at this one, I guess?
Representative Van Huysen, do you wish to answer that question?
I do.
Please do.
The other informational budgets we have are not agencies that have anything to do with general funds. They're for the most part boards that just collect fees and then spend their fees. This is an office that's otherwise generally funded, that's collecting money that goes into the general fund, and it has a general fund impact. That's why it makes sense to treat it like other generally funded agencies.
Further comments, Representative May.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate that answer. But the treasurer, that is an elected position, correct? Yes. So as an elected official, I think the accountability is already there for him to do a good job. If he wasn't doing a good job, there would be accountability through the process of an election. Just my opinion. Thank you.
Further remarks? Does anybody wish to speak before Representative Perry speaks a second time? Representative Perry.
Mr. Speaker, with that silence, I would say that means they want to hear my question. And this question is going to be for the sponsor of the bill, please. Please ask your question. This bill is shifting the burden for funding unclaimed property expenses to the taxpayers rather than being self-funded. How does that make things easier, or how does that make things better? And will the taxpayer, the person that receives the unclaimed property, will they benefit from this, or will their process slow?
Representative Van Huysen, do you wish to answer that question?
I do.
Please do.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I'm glad you asked it, because I want to correct that misconception. This does not shift the burden of funding unclaimed property onto the taxpayer. What it does is it takes those costs out at the back end after the transfer to the general fund, rather than at the front end before the transfer to the general fund. It doesn't affect the cost of the general fund at all. What effect does it have on someone making a claim? None. We're not cutting the budget for that. We're not making it administratively more difficult. If you're claiming unclaimed property, you will not notice a change.
Further remarks, Representative Perry. Further remarks on House Bill 1118. Okay. Just be at ease for a moment. We got a computer problem. You okay? While we're working the computer problem, I need to sign some bills. Under the Constitution, the presiding officer needs to sign bills during open session. I have before me House Bill 1129, an act to repeal session law authorizing the Board of Regents to contract for the design and construction of a new dairy research and extension farm on the campus of South Dakota State University and to declare an emergency. Have before me House Bill 1104, an act to enhance the penalty for accessory to first or second degree murder. For the students in the eye, these are bills that have passed both houses, and this is the signing process that starts it from between the chambers, and then it goes on to the governor for signature. House Bill 1091, an act to enact the Interstate Insurance Product Regulation Compact. House Bill 1163, an act to amend provisions of the Uniform Commercial Code. Hearing no further remarks, the question before the House is final passage of House Bill 1118. Those in favor will vote yea, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote. Representative Schaefbauer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker and members of the body, along with my district mate, Representative Perry, I would like to introduce and welcome the president of Northern State University, President Neil Schnorr. Thank you for coming today to watch us, and tomorrow is Aberdeen Day here at the Capitol, so welcome.
Speaker.
Oh, I'm sorry. Representative Mullally.
Thank you.
Mullally.
Thank you, Speaker.
Sorry, I didn't hear you.
That's all right. I just noticed that up to my right is former Governor Dugard and his wife. Welcome them.
Thank you, Representative Mullally. So I'm not the only one who's stolen mother-in-law points this week from Representative Van Huysen.
Representative Chafee.
Thank you, Representative Chafee, for voting.
Mr. Speaker, all members have voted.
Will the clerk please display the vote?
Mr. Speaker, there were ayes 39, nays 30, excused 1.
House Bill 1118, having received a majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the title? Hearing none, it is deemed correct. Representative Mortensen?
Mr. Speaker, are there any other announcements on the floor before I make a motion? No. Okay. I move we defer the balance of today's calendar to Thursday, February 22nd, the 28th legislative day.
The motion for us is to defer the balance of the calendar to Thursday. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay.
Nay.
Motion carries. Representative May.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. On behalf of Jamie Herman, he's the superintendent at Kadoka, and the Kadoka Board of Education, I want you to welcome the American government class from Kadoka, South Dakota, and their teacher, Mr. David Ortman, and their dean of students, Mr. Colby Shuck. So if you'd all give them a nice warm welcome. Thank you.
Also on our calendar today are three commemorations. House Commemoration 8022, celebrating the state championship win by the Mitchell High School gymnast team. House Commemoration 8023, commending and honoring Harrisburg School Board on a selection as the Associated School Boards of South Dakota's Outstanding School Board for 2023. And House Commemoration 8024, honoring Kelly Larson for his longstanding public service and congratulating him on his upcoming retirement. Further announcements. Representative Chase.
House Agriculture and Natural Resources, 7:45 tomorrow morning.
Representative Drury.
There will be no local government tomorrow.
Representative Blair.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. There'll be no House transportation tomorrow.
Representative Chafee.
No house tax tomorrow.
Representative Derby.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Joint Committee on Appropriations, 8 o'clock tomorrow. We have 16 bills.
Representative Deutsch.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. No house education on Friday.
Representative Jensen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Health and Health and Human Services. Sorry, I got education mixed in there. Human Services tomorrow morning, 7:45, four bills. Thank you.
Mr. Speaker.
Oh, Representative Derby.
I have a very important announcement. The annual legislator lobbyist intern pool tournament will be held next Tuesday night at the Long Branch starting at 6 o'clock. Thank you.
Further announcements. Representative Drury.
Mr. Speaker, I move this esteemed body be adjourned.
The motion before us is to adjourn. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay.
Nay.
Motion carries. I'd just like to congratulate the House members. This is a wonderful crossover day. We're done at 2:40. This is amazing, beats 10:30. Thank you all for your hard work, the committee chairs, and leadership.